You load up a game, only to find you can't hit your monitor's refresh rate without turning all the settings down to low. Or, maybe even worse, the game's devs didn't bother optimizing, so you're struggling to even get 60 FPS. This scenario has become all too common for most gamers, especially since prices for PC parts have become outrageous. You're still playing on decent hardware from a few years ago, or maybe you're gaming on a mobile system like the ROG Ally, Steam Deck, or gaming laptop. You just want to play with quality settings while still getting decent FPS, right? Here's where the Lossless Scaling app comes in. LS is a Steam app that will increase your FPS by leaps and bounds. It's used to inject upscaling and frame generation into any game with the click of a button. I've covered this app a few times already on my channel, but since then, there have been two major updates that require me to make a new video on lossless scaling. If this is your first time here, my name is Willy and welcome to my channel. I focus on hardware and software to improve gaming performance and visual quality. Now let's jump right into the Lossless Scaling app. First, let's talk about upscaling. I'm going to use Helldivers 2 as the example game here, but if the game you're using has DLSS or FSR built in, you'll get higher quality upscaling using those. Lossless scaling takes each frame individually and upscales spatially using the selected method. It doesn't have access to game vectors or previous frame data like DLSS or FSR 2 through 4. It does have FSR 1 as an option, but if you recall, this original form of upscaling is only per frame with no temporal element. Lossless scaling has 10 options for upscaling, including their own AI solution, LS1. Last November, they added Snapdragon Games Super Resolution. SGSR was created for mobile gaming devices with Snapdragon processors, like the Aya Neo Pocket S2, Meta Quest 3, phones, and laptops. It's supposed to compete with FSR 1 in quality, while also being more lightweight to run, extending battery life. Let's compare LS1, FSR, and SGSR. NIS is another option created by Nvidia, but as we found in my first lossless scaling video, it falls behind FSR in edge quality. At 1080p, FSR is better at cleaning up edges than SGSR, and LS1 goes further with slightly more detail. All three of these options are a nice improvement over native 1080p. At 900p, LS1 is pulling ahead. The upscaling provided is very good, but I would say FSR looks decent, just not as sharp. SGSR is still better than native 900p, though we'll have to see if it can give better performance to be worth the trade-off in quality. At 720p, the quality LS1 is able to extract is remarkable. Look at the grass and support beams in the distance here. FSR and SGSR can't keep up at this resolution and end up looking like a basic sharpening filter. FSR might be slightly better, but the planet's time of day lighting had changed, so it's hard to tell. Now let's test the performance between these options. I made an optimized settings guide video for Helldivers 2 last year, and you can check that out if you want the best balance between performance and visual quality. But to ensure we're pushing the GPU hard enough for this test, I'm going to max out the graphics settings. At native 1440p, my game is running at 91 FPS in this scene. Dropping the resolution to 1080p, LS1 is increasing performance by 20% to 110 FPS. A pretty substantial bump. FSR gets just slightly higher at 112 FPS, and SGSR squeezes out only 1 FPS above that. For the increase in quality, especially at 720p, I would choose LS1. If you're using LS at 900p or higher, FSR is a decent choice too, if you need to squeeze out some extra performance. Lossless Scaling's claim to fame arrived in January 2024 with the release of Lossless Scaling Frame Generation. My last video on this app was with the release of LSFG 2.2, giving us access to 3x frame gen and improved frame pacing. It's still a great overview if you want to know more about the history of frame interpolation and how frame gen works, so I'll leave a link to that video in the description. Since then, there have been multiple major updates to lossless scaling. 4x frame gen was added with improved motion handling on pattern textures and in dark scenes. LSFG 3.0 was introduced with even better motion handling, lower input latency, and the ability to multiply frames up to 20x. The most recent update added AFG, or adaptive frame generation. With this method, you can set the target frame rate and the LS app will automatically interpolate the necessary frames to hit that target. For example, let's say you're getting between 50 to 70 FPS in-game and you want to target your monitor's refresh rate of 120. Since you can't lock the game at 60 FPS and double that, you'd have to choose between tripling this variable 50 to 70 FPS and going way above your monitor's refresh rate, or locking the game at 40 FPS and tripling that to 120. Instead, you can now select adaptive and set the target to 120, letting LSFG dynamically interpolate frames to hit that target. This AFG mode isn't perfect though. It will introduce a small amount of lag and a higher GPU load, but depending on the system you have or the game you're playing, this trade-off might be worth it. Okay, enough talking about it, let's see how LSFG performs in motion. In these tests, I've got 30 FPS on the left, 60 on the right, and LSFG 30x2 in the middle. You can see artifacting in certain areas, like around HUD elements and the player, but it's not too bad when you aren't moving the camera around in circles. If I couldn't hit 60 FPS, I think the trade-off would be worth it. I would take a smooth 60 FPS with some artifacts over the judder of 30 FPS, especially on handhelds. These days, most gamers are using high refresh rate monitors. So, let's take a look at how LSFG performs at 120 FPS. Doubling 60 FPS to 120 delivers great results. Motion clarity is significantly improved, and artifacting is reduced to the point where it's barely noticeable during normal gameplay. Combined with lower input latency, there's really no downside, especially if your game's base frame rate struggles to reach the triple digits. But what if your system can't maintain 60 FPS? In that case, you can triple 40 FPS or even quadruple 30 FPS. These methods do work, but they introduce much more visible artifacting, particularly around the player model and disoccluded objects. The reason for this is simple. The lower the base frame rate, the more motion there is between each frame. Lossless scaling doesn't have access to depth buffers or motion vectors, so this makes frame generation increasingly difficult and artifact prone as you move from doubling to tripling or quadrupling lower frame rates. So here's the takeaway. Doubling 30 FPS to 60 works fine. Tripling 40 FPS to 120 is acceptable. But if you want to quadruple your frame rate, you'll need a stronger baseline for it to look clean. Something like going from 60 FPS to 240. A good rule of thumb is the higher your base frame rate, the better your frame gen results will be. If you have a 144Hz monitor, then tripling 48 will be slightly better than tripling 40, and if you have a 165Hz monitor, tripling 55 FPS is even better. With all this testing and calculating what frame rate to double, triple, etc., maybe you'd prefer if there was an easier way. Well, with Lossless Scaling's latest update, we got exactly this with Adaptive Frame Gen. Set your mode to adaptive and your target to your monitor's refresh rate, and there you go. Smooth FPS regardless of what random FPS your game is hitting. Now that we've covered upscaling and frame gen, let's put them together and see how they look. I'll leave the gameplay running at 50%, so if you're watching on a phone or a computer that supports 120fps, switch the playback speed to 2.0 and you'll get a feel for how smooth lossless scaling can make your games. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next one. Lost his shirt.